Thank you for being here. I'm a little rusty this morning. I haven't preached in a week and a half. So let me see if I can remember how to. How about that? Hallelujah. In church tonight, 6 p.m. Got some good music to play tonight. We should be a part of it. Vacation Bible School is upon us. It'll be happening in July. We should be a part of that. A lot going on. Big Father's Day service coming up. We're wanting the dads to be here. We have gifts for you. So thank you to all of our visitors. We've got several out traveling, several sick. Remember my pastor today. He's at White Level preaching today. Filling in over there. But Acts chapter 9, and where we are in this portion of Scripture, this is, when you think of amazing transformations, this surpasses Bruce Banner becoming the Hulk. Have you seen the new Incredible Hulk? Isn't that an incredible thing? I mean, that kind of blows the Lou Ferrigno one away a little bit. But I grew up on Lou Ferrigno being the Hulk. But now, you know, you got Mark Ruffalo and then this computer animated Incredible Hulk. This is just incredible that somebody can become this. And we know it's a movie. But that's what you would call an amazing physical transformation. But when we think of the things of God, we don't look at the physical, we look at the spiritual. And the most amazing spiritual transformation I've ever seen. I love the Old Testament stories of the adventures of David, what he went through. I love the stories of Joseph. I love prophecy. I love the parables of Jesus Christ. And of course, there's nothing greater than Jesus going to the cross and dying for you and I, and then coming back and returning on the third day of the resurrection. But something I can relate to is the transformation and the conversion of a man named Saul of Tarsus into what would be, he would be, the Apostle Paul. It's an amazing thing. This guy was me. How many have been watching AD, The Bible Continues, from the Bible series? I've seen, they went into a very long spin on just how ferocious Saul was going after the Christians. And I've never seen it portrayed quite to that level and that extent before. And so with that, we were able to see just how bad this guy was and just how much the Christians and feared him. He was a religious bounty hunter. And at this time, Christianity is spreading like wildfire, and the Pharisees and Sadducees, the Sanhedrin that make up the entire Jewish priest council, they plotted to have Jesus killed. So they wanted any trace of Jesus, any trace of him, to be shut out and stomped out. And so Christianity is spreading like wildfire, and they seek to stop this movement with a religious bounty hunter at the helm named Saul of Tarsus. And it says in verse 1 of chapter 9, this is famously known as the Damascus Road story. It says, "Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters, like warrants, from him to the synagogues of Damascus in Syria, the neighboring state, so that if he found any who were of the way, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem," the way being Christianity. "As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven. Then he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' And he said, 'Who are you, Lord?' Then the Lord said, 'I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads.' So he, trembling and astonished, said, 'Lord, what do you want me to do?' Then the Lord said to him, 'Arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do.'" Not what you have to do, but what you must do. There's a difference in what you have to do and what you've got to go do and what you must do. You see, something was about to change about this man. A purpose was about to overwhelm his life like never before. That surpassed far beyond religious tradition. Amen? And we're going to talk about that today. I want you to let this message soak in.
This is one of those messages that everybody in here ought to be able to relate to today. I'm not preaching down at you. I'm not preaching at you. I come with no condemnation. I come as a student receiving and wanting to hear this word and let this word take root in my life, just like yours. Amen? So I share this word with you. I don't preach it at you today. Can I get an amen? I'm going to ask Brother James Scott if he'd stand today and declare glory over this word today and what God's going to do through it. Go ahead, brother.
Dear Father, Lord, we thank you for this message that we're about to hear, Lord God. We pray that you would use our pastor. Lord God, speak through him. Let us hear what you would have us hear. Let us be changed, Lord God. Let us hear this word so that we can come forth from this place saying that we've been in your presence and in your house. Lord God, we thank you for what you've already done in this place. We thank you for the wonderful worship this morning. Lord God, we can't wait to hear what you have for us today. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Give God a shout of praise. Thank you for it. Hallelujah. Today's message asks the question, how do you transition when it's time to transition? Say it with me if you can. How do you transition when it's time to transition? Now, the word or term transition is defined as the process or a period of changing from one state or condition to another. And I've often thought of it meaning the process of adjusting to change. Whether you're in transition, using it as a noun, or you're transitioning, using it as a verb, you are in the process of adjusting to change. And the questions today is, how do we handle the change and do we follow through with the change? At some point in life, things can't remain the same. You can't remain in the same process. You can't remain in the same program. You can't remain in the same mindset. God is going to take you through changes. Can I get an amen? Amen. The aspect, element, and reality of change is in all facets of life, from human growth. All right, from human growth. I've got a young man, a 20-year-old young man, and I can remember holding him in my arms, and if I was to try to do that now, I'd hurt my back. He's huge. And I look at him sometimes and I said, where did the years go? I look at my little boy who just graduated from fifth grade. Hallelujah. And I think to myself, where have the years gone? We go through transition through human growth. We go through transition from education. We just saw these kids up here that are graduating from high school. They're going through transition now. All right, the ones leaving elementary school to go to middle school, or from middle school to high school, they're going through transition. Families go through transition. When divorce attacks a family, the vicious attack that is known as divorce. I hate divorce because God hates it. Come on, somebody. And divorce, for anybody who's ever been in a divorce, you know that divorce can turn your family upside down. It'll transit, and it hurts nobody worse. It affects nobody worse than the children involved. That transition can be hard for them. Those things happen. Families can lose people. You can lose somebody so precious in your family. And then you've got the transition through the mourning period and all those things. We've had all those things happening here in the church. People are going through transition in this church. Careers, where you may climb the ladder of success or you may get demoted. How do you handle that transition? You may get a raise in pay. You might get a cut in pay. How do you, Christian, handle that transition? How do you handle it? Technology. How do we handle that? Hallelujah. A new smartphone comes out every year, and you got to learn how to work it. And because you want it, you want that new iPhone, you want that new smartphone. And so you got to get used to that. All these different things. I've got a brand new super duper swimming pool pump that's better than that little cheap one they gave me that won't even pull a gnat out of the water. And now I'm trying to figure out how to work it. And so I've got to get with it, right? I've got to read the manual, even though I don't like to read no stinking directions. I'm a man. I get from here to California. I don't need no directions. I can put together things just by looking at the picture on the box, right? But I got to get with it, man. I got to get with it. The floats are ready to swim. When things change, how do you adjust? How do you adjust when things change in your life? Amen? Transition can be rejected or it can be embraced, right? It can be embraced or rejected. Certainly depends on what kind of change it is. Does it bring an immediate benefit, or does it turn your whole world upside down? There will be times when caution is necessary and times when you need to just get on board. Amen? You can't say, well, we used to do it like this, we used to do it like that. This is the way I prefer to do it. A lot of times we don't need that. We just need to know, are you on board? Are you on board? Come on. God's given the vision. Are you on board? I mean, you don't like that. A lot of people don't like that. We don't like to come away from the way we've done things. But when God gives the vision, amen, if we're going to get it, we got to get on board. We're going to be a part of it. Hallelujah. We got to get on board. But in this message today, we must examine ourselves in how we transition. So let's look at one of the greatest transitions in all of the Bible. It says in verse 1, chapter 9 of the book of Acts, it says, Saul still breathing threats, and y'all shout murder. This is how mad he was. Now I'm going to tell you, we look at Saul, and maybe I portrayed him a while ago, comparing him to the way the TV series. Maybe I portrayed him as a vicious man. But actually, he's a godly man. He was a godly man. What was driving him was God. The power of, well, let me back up. What he believed in God. What he perceived in God's Word. He was a Pharisaical student raised up by a man named Gamaliel. Y'all say Gamaliel. Gamaliel is an important guy in the Bible. He's so wise. And I believe that the movie, even the TV show even showed him as being older than the rest of them. We don't know that or not. But Gamaliel is the one who spoke up when they were ready to beat Peter and John when they laid hands on the lame man outside the beautiful gate. And he said, Gamaliel is the one who spoke up with wisdom and said, look, if these guys are a bunch of phonies, they'll fizzle out just like everybody else ever has ever risen up and said they're this or that. He said, but if they're of God, we won't be able to stop them. And so we see that Gamaliel was a very wise man. He's the one who's raising up, this wise Pharisaical teacher is raising up Saul of Tarsus. And Saul believes he's doing the right thing. He believed that Jesus Christ was a blasphemer. He didn't believe that he was the Messiah. That even hurts my soul and spirit to even say. But that's what he believed. He believed that the Christian movement, the Christian teaching, was false teaching. And it needed to be shut down. It was disrespectful to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It was disrespectful to the prophecies and the Old Testament teachings. And so he went out with great tenacity. And he was so angry at Christians that he was still breathing threats and murder at the time of this conversion. He was breathing not only threats, but murder. Now, murder is a sin. This is how mad Christianity had made this man of God. That he was willing to go to an extreme to even murder people over it. He was abandoning his own beliefs in the Ten Commandments that say, thou shalt not murder. This is how far he was going. This is how mad he was at the disciples of the Lord. But it says in the latter part of verse 3, it says, suddenly a light. Suddenly a light. Hallelujah. Thank God for the light of Jesus Christ that will shine in your life when you are dead wrong, when you are going down a path, even though you might think you're right in your own understanding. But when God flips the script, it's time for you to flip the script. It's time for you to get flipped. It's time for you to turn the page. It's time for you to roll with the changes. And when sometimes God's got to, he might have to knock you down. He might have to take a thing away or two. If you've been walking away from God's plan for your life, how much more are you willing to lose before you realize you need to open your eyes and see what God wants to do with you now? Hallelujah. Come on, if you want to give him praise, go ahead. It says that a light shined, and it was from heaven, and it was all around him. Now, we don't know whether or not the guards that were with him saw this or not. And I like the way that the television series the other week, when it showed this very event take place, it showed that they couldn't tell what was going on. But it was happening. It was happening. Nevertheless, it was happening. And they, of course, didn't believe what was going on. They just knew he was blind all of a sudden. And they had to lead him back. Alright, but it says that suddenly a light shone from around him from heaven. I'm not trying to preach a TV show this morning. I'm going to stick with the Word of God, alright? Suddenly a light shone around him from heaven, and then it says, then he fell. This high and mighty leader that had been commissioned by the Pharisees, and Caiaphas was the high priest at that time. He's the same man who ordered Jesus' crucifixion. Remember, Jesus wasn't executed like a thief on the right or left. Jesus was offered up by the high priest. He was offered up by the high priest because Pilate washed his hands. Caiaphas said, kill him. Caiaphas was the high priest, and only the high priest could offer up the sacrifice for the people's sins. Alright? And so here he is again. He's employed Saul to go after the Christians, bring them back. And man, he was bringing them back one by one after another. He even healed the coats of the people who stoned Stephen, the first Christian martyr. He was into this. He was going out. He was on a mission. He was trekking down the road to Damascus and all the way, and he was still breathing threats. He was mad. He was plotting murder against him. And all of a sudden, a light shined down on him so strong that he fell down. Hallelujah. And I remember when God rocked my world and told me it is time for you to quit serving yourself. It's time for you to quit serving this world and the devil that controls it. It's time for you to serve me. It's time for you to get kingdom minded. And I fell down. And hallelujah. And I've been down ever since, praising him, seeking him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, come on. You've got to fall down before Jesus. You've got to say, God, I can't do this anymore. I can't do this anymore. I need you. Because when I try to do it, I make excuses to why I'm not where I should be by now. Amen? And God doesn't want your excuses. He wants change. He wants you to transition. He wants you to roll in what he's doing. It says, then he fell to the ground and he heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Now this is Jesus saying this. This is a man that Saul believes is dead. And he's saying, why are you persecuting me? Now listen to this. Saul don't believe in Jesus, right? He thinks Jesus is an imposter. But Jesus says, why are you persecuting me? And then immediately, Saul says, who are you? And he don't just say, who are you? He says, who are you, Lord? That means even in this moment where he don't really know what's going on, he recognizes that this voice is holy. He recognizes that this voice is all powerful and sovereign, and it is coming from heaven. Hallelujah. It's been bred from heaven. And so he recognizes him immediately as Lord. He recognizes him as somebody supernatural and over him with authority. And he immediately says, Lord. Then Jesus said, he said, then the Lord said, I am. I am. Identifying himself as God. Hallelujah. I am Jesus. Right? The very person you think is a dead man that they killed and crucified a while back. But I'm alive. I'm standing right in front of you. And so he says, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Alright? And then he said, it is hard for you to kick against the goads. Now a goad was a motivating prod that was used to drive and urge animals and motivate them. And Christians were motivated. Saul might have been persecuting them and bringing them back, but he wasn't getting any of them to change back. He wasn't getting any of them to refute Jesus Christ. And so he certainly wasn't going to change Jesus' mind, and the mission that he was on to Damascus just got shut down. So Jesus said, it's hard for you to push against and fight against something that's so motivated. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, Christians, when you get discipled, when you get full of the Holy Spirit, you will be so motivated that the world can't pull you back just like that anymore. If you're tired of struggling and the world will get you to question things and pull you back, do I have time to pray? I don't feel like praying. Do I have time to read the Bible? Do I feel like going to church today? It won't be something that you've got to do or you have to do. It'll be an I must in your spirit to say, yes, I must pray. Yes, I must read the Word. Yes, I must go to church. I've got to be there. Hallelujah. I got to get my praise up. Hallelujah. Because I love Jesus and I have changed from who I used to be. Amen. And so you're motivated. You're motivated. You've been urged by God. And therefore you've changed. You've responded to the transition. Trembling and astonished, after he's told who this is, that it's Jesus, he still refers to him as Lord. He still responds as Lord. There's no question.
There's no, wait a minute, you're the one I'm trying to shut down. There's no, you're the one that I think is a liar. There's no, you're, wait a minute, you're the one that I thought, you're the one that I feel like has been blaspheming. I don't really agree with what you're saying. You're the one this, no. He responds immediately. He says, who are you? Jesus says, I'm Jesus. He says, Lord again. Lord again. He met him with worship. He met him with reverence. Hallelujah. Have you met Jesus with worship? Have you met Jesus with reverence? Have you identified him as the Lord of your life? The Lord of your thoughts? The Lord of your mind? The Lord of your home? The Lord of your family? The Lord of all? Yes. Hallelujah. He immediately identified him as Lord again. And he said, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? That's the key right there. That's the gist of the sermon right there that I'm trying to get to you right now. Alright? Check this out. Listen. What do you want me to do? He responded to the transition. Here's a guy who was all gung-ho about shutting down Christianity. And in just one encounter, one over-the-top moment, he's saying, Lord, what do you want me to do now? Because I realize the game plan has changed. And I'm not here to fight against it anymore. I'm not here to reject it. I'm here to embrace it and get on board. Are you ready to embrace what Jesus has for your life? Come on. Don't reject it anymore with your excuses. Don't reject it anymore with your traditions. Come on. Hallelujah. Don't let religion back you up anymore. Go after Jesus Christ with all that you have. And go after that relationship. Hallelujah. That Jesus has for you. Somebody give him a shout of praise. Lord, what do you want me to do? That's how he transitioned when it was time to transition. Now, I'm not going to read the rest of the verses, but we know what physical state was Saul in when he left that encounter? Blind. He couldn't see. We're taught a lot of times, don't go into something blind. Don't go into it blind. And I know the Bible says count the cost. But just like love is blind, people say love is blind. People will do a whole lot of things for love. They'll do things they never thought they'd do for love. There was a country song years ago that said, now I'm opening umbrellas and opening up doors. I'm taking out the trash and I'm sweeping my floor. Crossing my fingers and counting every kiss. Praying that it keeps going on like this. Hallelujah, that man was in love. Hallelujah. Praise God, I want to sing a chorus. Now, y'all get the chorus out of your mind right now. I rebuke it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. But he was doing things like he never thought he'd do before because he was in love, right? Love can be blind. Love can be blind, but guess what? So should faith. Faith should be blind. Is it not the Apostle Paul who Saul would later on become, who teaches us in the Bible that we live by faith and not by sight? That we walk into things not having to know what the outcome is, but if God told you to do it, you walk into it. And here is this big, bad, religious bounty hunter who was going out, and the Christians were scared to death of him. They were hiding. But now here he is, blind, having to be led. Led. He couldn't even see on his own. He didn't know where he was going. Hallelujah. When you exalt yourself, you will be humbled. Hallelujah. If you humble yourself, he will exalt you. But if you exalt yourself, you will be humbled. Now he's humbled. He's humbled. At this same time, a man in town named Ananias is told, Saul of Tarsus is coming. Jesus tells him that. He comes to him in a vision too. Alright? And all of a sudden, Ananias says, whoa! Saul of Tarsus! What's he coming to see me for? Is he coming to kill me? Is he coming to take me back in chains? I don't want nothing to do with that guy. He's bad news. I don't want to see him. Jesus says, don't worry about who he used to be. Worry about him. All you need to focus on is who he is now. Amen. I've said it before and enough time. I know I've been saying long enough now. Anybody walks in this church and says, is that the drunk that used to pass out in the corner at the club? Is that the one they used to have to take out of there? Is that the one that used to be here and there and doing all these different things? If that's what somebody thinks, they need to get on board with what God's doing with me now. And what he's done in the last 7 years. It's like anybody that walks in that door, we got to give them a chance because Jesus wants to give them a chance. And when they mess up, guess what? We got to give them another chance because God's got grace. Grace. We got to love them. Hallelujah. But here he is, Ananias is now having to get on the game plan. Because here's what he thought. Saul, bad. Stay away from Saul. Now he's being told by Jesus, Saul, good. Embrace him. So now he's got to transition. He's got to change. Because, oh, no. This is what God's doing now. All right? This is what God's doing now. He's converted to Christianity. Hallelujah. You need to go lay hands on him. You need to go lay hands on him so he can be healed. And we know that that happened. So Saul's blindness made it where he had to go into something humble. Ananias' reluctance caused him to have to come away from what he had thought and embrace what God was doing now. How do you transition when it's time to transition? We can pick it up in verse 19. It says, so when Saul had received food, he was strengthened. Then Saul spent some days with the disciples. That reminds me of discipleship. He spent days with the disciples. He got discipled first. He wasn't going to go out and try to do something blindly. He got discipled first. He was ready. He was pumped up. But he had to spend some time with Peter and John and the others. And they were accepting him. And they were realizing that he was the real thing. He got discipled first. Hallelujah. And then it says, once he did, in verse 20, immediately he preached the Christ in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. Hallelujah. He transitioned when it was time to transition. He changed when it was time to change. And he did something about it. Hallelujah. He got discipled, then he preached. And it says, then all, verse 21, then all who heard were amazed and said, is this not he who destroyed those who call on this name in Jerusalem and that had come here for that purpose so that he might bring them back to the chief priests? Is this the same guy who was going around with breathing threats and murder and now he's preached against Jesus? Now he's preaching for Jesus? I relate to this story. I've had people walk in and say, look, I'm from another church and I love my church, but I had heard that you had got saved and were preaching. I just had to come out here and see if it was true. God bless you. I love you. I'm going back to my church now, but I had to see it for myself. Hallelujah. Praise God. Your transition and your response to transition can impact others. You don't know who's watching you. Especially those little ones at home. When they hear mom and dad going at it, cussing each other out. When they've seen, witnessed physicals, verbal abuse. Yet all of a sudden, a supernatural transformation takes place. And mom and dad are serving God together. And they see that and they are amazed by that. And all they know is they don't know the Bible yet. They don't know all the doctrine and all these things. All they know is now that they're calling on the name of Jesus, it's brought peace to our home. They're not fighting each other no more. They're not calling each other names. They're not fighting and scratching anymore. Our home is not a war zone anymore. It's a place of peace. And a seed is sown in that young life right there that Jesus is good.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I learned at an early age when I began to pray at 8 years old, God, bring my mom and dad back together again. They were separated for 4 years. I would get down on my knees every night and say, God, I don't want to live apart from my daddy. I want my mom and my daddy together. And then one day they pulled up in the truck together. I said, what are they doing in the same vehicle? And daddy looked at me and said, get in the back of the truck. We're going home, son. We're going home. And I learned at 8 years old. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. And so, we see that his transition impacted others. Saul hadn't been wrong. I want you to listen to this. I'm about to wrap it up. Anybody get anything out of it?
Yeah.
Saul hadn't been wrong in what he'd been taught initially, right? He'd been taught the Ten Commandments. He'd been taught the Jewish customs. He'd been taught about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He only became wrong after Jesus, right? Once Jesus came, once Jesus taught who he was, once Jesus died on the cross and rose again, because Saul didn't believe it. He's wrong. He was wrong. He passionately sought to shut down Christianity. Then he embraced it. After his own encounter with Jesus. There's four things, and I know you're probably thinking after I name these four things, you're probably going to say, well, there's a whole lot more than that. But I'm going to give you four things that an encounter with Jesus will do. An encounter with Jesus will excite you. Say excite. An encounter with Jesus will inspire you. Say inspiration. An encounter with Jesus will also convict you. Say conviction. And that conviction ought to lead to a change. Say change. See, a lot of times people have an encounter with Jesus at church
or wherever at a prayer meeting at a revival, and they get excited, they get inspired, but they don't let that conviction change them. And so they feel kind of pumped up, and they say, well, you know what, I'm gonna listen to some Christian music. Yeah, I like that little bumper sticker. Now, I'm going to put that on my car and represent Jesus. I'm going to wear that t-shirt and I'm going to represent Jesus. And what we have is a bunch of exterior surface stuff going on. But nothing's happened inside of here yet. There's no change. So that's why it's very easy for us to call on the name of Jesus. It's very easy for us to go to church and shout and wear the stuff. Amen. And do all the things. But when temptation comes, we just give in because we ain't changed. And so we go out and we commit adultery. Hallelujah. And we still say, I love you, Jesus. We go out and we fornicate. And we still say, I love you, Jesus. We look at pornography on our computer screens and even on our phones. And we say, I love you, Jesus. And we poison our bodies with alcohol and drugs and the things that we're supposed to be coming away with, coming away from. Amen. And we still say, I love you, Jesus. Amen. But you're only giving Him surface, exterior stuff. And He wants your heart. He didn't die for the outside of you. He died for the inside. Come on. He died to change you from the inside out. Hallelujah. What do you do when it was time to change? Did you? What happened to you in your encounter with Jesus? What happened? Did you change? Or did you just get goosebumps? Get goosebumps? T.D. Jakes gave a great word one time about goosebumps. Amen. He said, I thought the Holy Ghost was goosebumps. When I hear a good song at church, I get the goosebumps. I like that song. He said, but when I got in college, I snuck out one night. My mom and daddy did not know, and I went to see Tina Turner. And there was Tina, rolling on the river. And y'all know how Tina dressed. And I got the goosebumps there. And I said, wait a minute, this ain't got nothing to do with church. So he realized that the power of God is more than just goosebumps. Amen? The power of God's going to baptize you with fire. The power of God's going to change you. The power of God's going to turn you away from your old ways. The power of God is going to say, I reject sin because God hates it and I love God. Come on. It's more than goosebumps. We can get goosebumps all day. Oh, I got goosebumps right now. You know why? The air just blew on me. We cranked it on down to 70 degrees today. I got a little bit of the goosebumps right now. Come on. He's more than goosebumps. He's more than goosebumps. What happened to you when you had an encounter with Jesus? Did you just get excited and inspired for a little while? Or did you let that conviction result in a change? Here's something else. What about the ongoing change, Christian? Once you say yes to Jesus, get on fire for God. What about the ongoing change? Is there an ongoing change? Don't you just change and then you're changed? Well, how about this? Give me 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. I'm going to close with this. Saul of Tarsus would later become the Apostle Paul. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, he said, but we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed. That's being changed. We're being changed. We're being transitioned. We're being transformed into the same image. He's refining us like gold. He's burning off the impurities. That's what happens in a refining process. Transformed into the same image from glory to glory. Higher and higher. Level upon level. Day by day. Month by month. Year by year. Come on. Trial through trial. Tragedy and pain. Good times and the bad. He's transforming us into the same image from glory to glory. Just as by the Spirit of the Lord. We're changing. As a Christian, you'll change. You'll go higher and higher. We talk about the process the other week called sanctification. It is the will of God for your life, Christian. If you said yes to Jesus, sanctification is the will for your life that brings righteousness.
that brings holiness. Yet we've been given excuses in the modern day church for so long now of why we don't have to change. And grace has been thrown at us in a wrong manner. God is filled with grace. He's the God of second, third, fourth, and fifth chances. Hallelujah. If it weren't for grace, wouldn't none of us be able to even serve God or praise God? If it weren't for His grace, I would not even be able to stand in this pulpit. We need grace. Hallelujah. But we need to change. We need to change from who we were. So if we're going to witness for Christ and increase the kingdom, come on. People can see the fruit bore in your life. Jesus said you'll know about the fruit. Yet we've been given a free pass that says you don't have to bear no fruit in your life. Don't worry about it. You don't have no fruit, you just come on like you are. Yeah, come like you are, but desire to have some fruit. Desire to bear some fruit in your life. Come on. Where are we now with God? Where are you now with the Lord? Well, I've been saved for 5 years. Are you still drinking spiritual milk or have you gotten on the meat yet? Are you sitting at the big boy in your table yet? Or are you still at the little Fisher Price plastic one? You're going to break that seat when it's over with. Better get your big hind parts out of that little seat. It's time to come to the big boy table. Come on, somebody, back me up. Where are we at now? Well, I'm still doing this. Still working on this. I'm a work in progress. I'm a work in progress. I'm doing it. Yes, there's a process, yeah. But come on. What part of you just doesn't want to come away from what you want to hold on to? I still want this. I still like this. I still want this. Is there any difference in you now that you say you're a Christian than when you weren't? When you weren't, then when you weren't? Come on. Hallelujah. Nobody likes this kind of preaching. It's not going to pack a church out. It's not. But it is the truth. It is the truth. And it's not really condemnation. Hallelujah. I have to change. When God transitions me, I have to. When He chastens me, I said, you can't let another day go by without crying out to me. You can't let another day go by that you just sit down and prepare a sermon, but you don't seek me in the Word. Hallelujah. See, a lot of times I've already sought Him in the Word. Then I prepare a sermon. Right? But He wants me to prepare that sermon, but that was yesterday's thought. He's got a new thought for me today that He wants me to go after. And maybe He'll give me a sermon on it later on. But I got to seek Him. I got to seek Him. Pastor, you're kind of hard on yourself. Well, you know what? To whom much is given, much is required. To whom much is given, much is required. Where are you now with God? Are you making excuses for where you're not at yet? Hallelujah. Because look, it's going to come down to this. After a year, after 2 years, after 3 years, after 4 years, after 5 years, after 7 years, after 11 years that you've been claiming Christianity, but you're still doing the same things you used to do. You're still falling. Anger overcomes you. And you just kick and cuss and blow everything all out of the water. Use His name all in vain and say, well, He's got grace to cover me. Well, guess what? He's got grace to cover you when you truly and sincerely repent and say, my God, you heard that. Holy Ghost, you heard that. You heard that, what I just said. You heard how I just used your name. But when you say, you know what? I don't really care. I said it this time, and I'm going to say it again. I thought it this time, and I'm going to think it again. I did it, gave into it this time, and I'll do it again. Come on. He is our high priest. We can go straight to the throne. And you need to realize, even though mom and dad don't see it, even though the church doesn't see it, even though the pastor doesn't see it, the Holy Ghost sees everything. He sees everything. The Lord sees everything. And I know I preach that till I'm blue in the face. But I'm going to share my heart with you for a moment. Can I just be real for a minute? Then I'm going to close it out and you go do whatever y'all want to do. Go eat. Come back tonight. Lately, the parable of the four soils has been coming to my heart.
Yes, yes.
And before Jesus ever talks about any of the soils that take root, the first thing He says is the seed was thrown out. Listen there. Please don't let the devil rob you right now. But that's what I'm about to tell you about. It's how the devil is robbing people in this church.
That's right.
He's robbing people in these pews. Listen. When the
seed's thrown out, the fowl of the air comes and gobbles it up.
There's nothing about it taking root. There's nothing about it going in the ground. There's nothing about it being watered, fertilized, growing. It's gone just like that. And what that is a picture of the enemy getting you so sidetracked. He might have you thinking about a steak right now, rather than one Satan. He might have you thinking, if the weather's good today, I might can get in 9 holes. If the weather's good today, I might can hit a pond. If the weather's good today, we might can cook out tonight. If the weather's good, you just think about all kinds of things. You might have Disney, you might be going to Disney World next week. Hallelujah. Congratulations. Get rest. We're going to be talking about rest and all that. We need that. But when the Word of God is coming to you, you don't have time to be looking at your phone. You don't have time to be looking at Facebook. Come on. The Word of God is being shared. You don't have time to play games on your iPod or whatever. Come on. The Word of God is being shared. And every distraction is that fowl of the air coming down to gobble up the seed before it even has a chance to take root. And you've been robbed of the gift that God wanted to give you today and every Sunday and every Wednesday night. Because if it was taking root, the change would be apparent. Hallelujah. The maturity would take place. The growth would increase. And we would say with humility, I must decrease so that He can increase. And guess what? When you decrease, He increases you. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. And we change. And we're able to handle transition. We're able to handle stress. We're able to handle attacks. And we won't always do it perfectly. We'll make mistakes, yes. But my God, we'll look like the church that He died for and not the world that He has sought to save us from. Come on. How do you transition when it's time to transition? Do we roll with the changes or do we make excuses to why we can't change? Did anybody get anything out of this today? Thank you, Jesus.